We're talking Chapter 6, The Monster. Stay tuned.
The Stranger Things After Show, presented by Netflix.
Welcome to the Stranger Things After Show, presented by Netflix. These are my friends, and they're crazy. Roxy Stryer.
Lego my ego.
Tiana Hobson.
She threw you in the mind with her, in the air with her mind.
It was so close, girlfriend.
And Zach Wilson.
Today we make history by being the first after show to talk about episode 6 of Stranger Things.
No. And we kind of made contact with the monster.
The monster is here, guys.
Yeah.
Well, so the end of last episode, we saw Nancy was in the netherworld, and she had awoken the monster after he was eating a deer, and she's freaking out, hiding behind this tree, and we see the flashlight. Jonathan realizes where the entrance port is. He flashes the light in it. She notices it. She jumps through the tree. He saves her. What was going through your mind? Did you think she was going to get attacked? I felt like her leg was going to get pulled.
Yeah, I thought we were going to be dealing with, like, could have been a Winnie the Pooh situation. Yeah.
Tug of war.
Yeah. In the hunt.
I just usually, when one thing can go this way or that way, I can predict, okay, maybe it will go this way. I didn't even know there was a this way or that way. I figured she's going to get stuck in there. All of us on our Chapter 5 panel, we said, no, she's in the tree, and that's where she's going to stay. And she's going to hang out with Barb, and she's going to do her thing. She's going to run from some monsters. It wasn't even crossing my mind that we could get her back.
Right. We saw the tree starting to close, and I think we all just were like, well, bye, Nancy.
Bye, Felicia.
Nancy, it's all up to you now, so find Barb and Will.
But no, I mean, she made it back just in time. Like luckily, like, the flashlight just poked through the gateway.
So is it closed? 100%, or is it like a hiding thing where it closes so that you can't see it? It's like camouflage?
For the time being, this portal seems to be closed.
It still remains to be seen if the portal is connected to a location or if it can just open up wherever. I mean, the fact that it's in a physical thing and not just like in the air. Like, it was in the wall at the, like, what we see at the end here, and it was in a tree. We don't know where it was at Steve's house.
Right.
But it seems like it needs to be in a physical thing. So maybe maybe there's something special about this tree or its exact location on the earth.
Which is interesting, because she brought Jonathan back to the womb.
Yeah.
Totally innocent. She was scared.
Completely legitimate.
Yeah.
Completely legitimate, but you don't trust your boyfriend enough to tell him what happened, and I wouldn't either. How are you going to say, hey, Steve, by the way, here's what's up. He slept over last night because we were out in the woods, and there was, like, totally this monster. But beforehand, we went shopping together.
And went into the netherworld.
And I went through this tree, and it was a little bit strange, and that's why you saw me swinging that bat before, because I was totally scared of this monster. You get it, right?
I'm a really good shot, by the way. You didn't know that about me.
If you didn't know.
I mean, there's just no way. I feel like she's in a pickle here, because how is she supposed to get across to her boyfriend? I legitimately didn't do anything
with
this guy.
He lost his brother. I lost my best friend. And we're the only two that care. He was consoling me because you ain't Steve.
Yes, and
he tried. Steve came over.
I mean, he came over, but
where's the hunt?
It was a little too late. He came, he was kind of a douche before that.
I really feel like Steve did try to come be there for her. The morning after they had sex, he wasn't really there for her. After that, he did try to come and hang out and talk to her and be with her, but she kind of pushed him away, and now she is leaning on Jonathan. They're in more similar situations, and I get why she's doing that, but having another man sleep in your bed and not explaining it to your boyfriend and pretending you can't hang out with him because you're doing something else, sketchy.
But at the same time, she doesn't know what he saw, and we know that Steve only saw Jonathan sitting on the bed with his arm around her, which could mean many things.
I think she's assuming that he saw them sleeping in the same bed.
Yep.
Which is like, if somebody was seeing the room, like, you have to imagine the worst case scenario.
Yeah. No, she did just lose her best friend, and he wasn't the most sensitive to that situation either. He wasn't sensitive about Jonathan's brother missing and the fact that Jonathan's family and her family are connected because their brothers are friends, and just the toll that it could take on her as well. Steve hasn't been there.
I was totally with him, though, being upset about the situation. What he should have done, and what Zach Wilson, good guy, would have done, is, hey, by the way, Nancy, can we talk? Last night I came over and I saw this. I want to give you a chance to explain what happened. Or even gotten pissed at her. But what you don't do is go to your town movie theater, and we know this is a small town, so everybody's going to see this, and just write Nancy the slut face slut slut on every single thing you see. That's messed up.
Yeah, that's the thing. From Steve's perspective, I totally understand him being mad. It's perfectly reasonable to be mad. Like, look, he hasn't been the nicest guy through this, but he also hasn't been, like, a total jackass. Like, he could have done better. But, like, I'm just saying, like, he could be a lot worse. And, like, from his perspective, this girl that he was seeing, like, maybe there's no ring on there. He didn't give her his jacket.
He didn't pin her.
But
we're in the 80s. We're not in the 40s.
Right. I don't know.
They had sex. That locks it down.
Yeah, but that at least, like, warrants a conversation before another guy comes into the picture. And so what he saw seemed like cheating to him. Being pissed is one thing. Spray painting rumors on a billboard, not okay.
Amen.
I love that they, within the whole shower and the scary flashbacks, she ends up having him sleep in the bed. But I love that they figured out, that it was almost like you, how you've been putting the pieces together. They figured out that the blood.
Yes.
Might have something to do. Like, finally we're thinking. Like, finally people are, like, starting to put clues together versus, like, I don't know. Like, it's like the boys, they're trying, but they're kids. Joyce and Hopper are on...
They're going down a different street right now.
But that's the weirdest part, because we've had the boys together as a unit this entire time, and everybody else is individuals, and now the boys are breaking up, and everybody else is getting together.
Yep.
Joyce and Hopper, Jonathan and Nancy, even Steve with his crew doing the bad thing, but everybody's starting to join up right when our core group is splitting apart.
It even looks like there's a good chance Jonathan and Nancy are going to join forces with Hop and Joyce.
I want that to happen.
Because they're at the police station.
So, yeah, I mean, we know that Joyce and Hop are on their way there. You have to imagine, because, like, Jonathan knows that his mom is aware of, like, all the supernatural stuff going on. So he's going to be like, look, we're trying to get ready for, like, this is all bad, like, whatever, I'm sorry. We know the monster's real, and that's when they're going to go, oh, we got to get him out of here, get to the woods with these bear
traps.
And we've
been waiting for this conversation, because it should have happened, but Lonnie, you done blocked it.
Yeah.
So finally, we can have it in the police station, hopefully, and they can go straight from there.
Mm-hmm.
All right, so Hopper and Joyce, though, we got to talk about this, because talk about putting the pieces together. They're talking about the lab. They go, they realize that it wasn't Will. So they go to Miss Terry Ives' house.
That was cool, though, with the drawing when she was like, not my son, and pulled it out, because I feel like all of the foreshadowing moments earlier on that we didn't realize, but by talking about the person that was going to that jumped into the water, by looking at him make that drawing, all these things came back, which just shows how well thought out the show was.
Love
that
show. They visit Terry Ives. That's where the sister said, well, if you're trying to get her to talk, 5 years too late, the MK Ultra conversation comes up. The CIA basically paid Terry a couple $100 every time she would go do this. They would give her drugs, go into an isolation tank, which that's a real thing. They put you in this isolation tank, like how we see Eleven going into it all the time. And at the time, Terry was pregnant.
What?
So before we really put all the pieces together, what was going on through your heads in this moment with Terry?
I mean, at that moment, like the moment they dropped, like she was pregnant during MKUltra, I was, oh, it's 11. I got so excited because like the implications of that, it's because, yeah, all those experiments, they might not pay off with that first person, but the way that it can, like all those drugs and everything, it infects a being from the moment of its conception. Then yeah, that could.
Tiana just started
rubbing. I was saying like it was like a baby, you know.
In my bed.
Something you want to tell us?
No.
Continue that.
When you start in like injecting a baby, like a fetus with all that stuff as it's growing, it's in the development stages that's when all the, this cool science and science fiction, of course, like starts to take place where it's like bending just the way that it grows. And if it grows in a slightly different way, it starts to go into that territory where you hit like Lucy or Limitless, where like the brain like is like just a little bit away from having crazy powers
and
abilities.
Think, that Terry thought they were doing the test on her, it was really them priming the baby.
No, I think it was a happy accident where they went like, oh, she was pregnant during all that? Well, we gotta test the baby. And then the baby had all these powers and they kept her.
So. I agree.
And maybe while she was doing these experiments, since it was, you know, the psychedelic drugs and everything, her and Dr. Martin were getting it on, and that's why he knew she was pregnant. And
you think it's Brenner's baby?
Yeah, because the Papa thing. And I know I said I thought she wasn't talking about him specifically, but to flash forward, we did see her address him directly as Papa tonight. So then I started thinking, unless he just taught her to do that, it could be that he is the actual father, because he's got this woman who's on drugs. He's kind of controlling, giving her money. They could have had a thing, and that's why Terry knew as much as she knew.
I think he's not her biological father, but if they took her from the moment of her birth, he would have been the person that raised her. So I think he just told her to call him Papa.
Yeah. I have a few questions about this situation. Number one, if you remember a couple chapters ago, Zach, you predicted something, and I was saying I don't feel that way because Eleven wouldn't be kicking and screaming as much if she is a preteen and this has been happening her whole life. At that point, I feel like she would just go with it. So if they have had her from birth, which it seems that they have, was there a period of time where they let her live a more normal life? Did it take them a while to unleash these powers? Was she kind of with 1 through 10 and going through school and doing something normal? Or have they been doing all of these tests since she was a kid? She's hated it this entire time. And so that's my first question. The second question would be about the dad. Does she call him Papa because she literally has no idea who her parents are and they took her from her parents and this is the only person she's known and he said, call me Papa, and that's what she does? Or is it, like you said, legitimately her dad? So many questions.
I mean, I could definitely see it legitimately being her dad. That would be really an interesting. Like, because here's my thing. Well, I think Terry thought that the tests were on about her, but I don't. I kind of personally think that they knew she was pregnant because the kid is marked 11, which means that they are training these kids.
They probably have to test her, too, before they do any tests on her, like test her blood, test all these things to see if she's a candidate for this.
What if they had multiple kids and they started doing tests on them at certain ages and they started her tests at age 11 and that's when they marked her?
That could be it, too, but to your first question about the upbringing, I think that, well, when she's an infant, clearly, you know, they're not doing anything. I feel like they waited. They might have put her in isolation. She still was raised alone, but they had to wait for her to start showing the signs of these natural abilities, because I don't think she would have necessarily known what she was doing, and they wouldn't have had a way to control her when she was, like, 2 or 3. But maybe once she hit 5, 6 and then
can start moving
and a little bit more aware of brain functions and stuff.
Because I'm wondering if she spoke to her mother in the womb. Because how would Terry know that her child has these powers and this connection and she knows her daughter's still alive and she knows these things aren't true? So I'm wondering if when they were doing all that stuff, Eleven was communicating to her mother, and they have this kind of almost connection.
Because, see, that's why I think that Dr. Martin is connected to this somehow, too, because Terry knows so much, and she wouldn't have had all that information unless there was a way, like you're saying, Jesse, that Eleven could communicate to her from the womb, or if she was actually still just there with him for a while and then saw what they were doing and didn't want it and tried to get Eleven out of there. And so then they kick her out, paint her as like this crazy person, but she has all the information. She knows the facts.
Mm. Is there any chance that Eleven isn't Terry's kid and a similar situation happened to Terry, but they've been doing this to a lot of people and Eleven is one example of somebody?
I if not for the like the flashbacks that they show or like the clips that they like threw in there, like I would say maybe, but I think the show is very clear, like that's supposed to be her daughter.
Okay.
Because that was the first time we've ever seen an actual conversation in them referencing.
Right. Yeah, I will say I think there's a good chance that they didn't mean to be experimenting on like a pregnant woman or a kid, because the fact that she has a nursery set up suggests to me that was already set up. when she went to the facility or went to a hospital to have her baby, and it was then that they discovered that she maybe she gave birth and then the baby like was crying and blew up the like inside of the room, like threw stuff across the room or something like that, and that's when Hawkins' lab starts getting in on the, they like go and they take the baby away and like tell her it was a miscarriage and just straight up lie to her. But I think she was outpatient for all the lab experiments. I don't think they were keeping her there because they make sure to tell us that it was voluntary.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Unless the nursery was built after everything happened and she was just hoping that her baby would come home and she'd find them or something.
That's possible too.
Both ways. I could see it happening both ways.
11 got her flashback where we see her. Today we make history. Today we make contact. They put her back into that tank and we see her basically make contact with the monster.
From what they understood, sending her in there, he could not hurt her while she was in the tank. But then we see that the monster in that moment creates the rift. So her touching him, so her being in our plane and him being in that plane and them physically touching is what caused this to open?
That's possible.
Isn't that two pieces of paper touching?
Maybe. I think it may have been that when she's in the tank, it's sort of like astral projection in a way. So, like, she's going into... She's just putting her, like, image into, like, in her thoughts into that other dimension. And so she goes over and she's touching it, and it becomes aware. And I think it's when she screams. Like, she's so afraid, and she is so powerful that when she unleashes a scream, she unleashes whatever power she has in her and unintentionally, because she's connected to this other realm, rips it open. Mm. Just like she could rip open a real wall, she rips open a wall in space-time.
Mm. It's so sad that she believes she was the monster because of that, though.
Well, that, but think about it. She was raised to think that.
I'm not saying it's not legitimate, but it was sad. Yeah. It was really sad. Yeah.
I don't think she thinks she's the physical monster. I think she thinks that because it's her fault that the monster is here. So she's the monster that created this whole problem for everyone.
Well, maybe we don't see what happens immediately after all of that. They may blame her in some way where she starts to feel like she's responsible for people getting hurt. I mean, she did kill two guys and now she's out in the world and she's hurting people again. Like, that's more than enough to make somebody feel like they're a monster.
Do you guys believe them when they say that the monster is calling her? Or is that just something that they're saying to make her...
I'm unclear about her connection with the monster now, what exactly the relationship is, and if she is able to sense it, if it's able to sense her, what's going on there. I'm not sure.
Yeah, that's what I'm most interested to find out. Like, I still want to know, like, what is the... Like, we know the monster is trying to feed, but we don't know what it is, like, looking for, or, like, if other than just, like, food, Brenner does imply that there's a connection. He says it's calling out to you, it wants you, don't turn away from it. And I know he's just trying to get her ready, but it seems that there's no way she would just connect to a random creature. There's a reason that she found it.
Did you think he looked happy when that was happening? I was trying to, like, read his emotion when she started screaming, the lights started
going. The monster
going.
Or the papa?
Papa. I was just, I don't know, because it was like almost like a little smirk, but then everyone was running around.
He's
like,
a scientist. I mean, he's excited. This is new. Any scientist discovering something new is excited.
Yeah. That's did they true. Create the monster, or did they find the monster?
Well, that's interesting, because when Nancy opened that book up and she pointed to the shark, it was the first time I was like, maybe they created this monster, or maybe they had her create the monster in her head and she's capable of, I was going there, but why I said that was when the shark part happened, I was like, are they testing out taking all these different species? And Levin then goes, she's running in the woods and she comes across that pond, right? And she looks into it and she screams and it like
ripples across,
shot this thing, which I'm assuming that's exactly how the rift that you put that, actually that just came together, came about. She goes to the grocery store.
That's my favorite part.
It was a really
but the clerk, he kind of pissed me off, y'all, because yes, she walked in there looking dirty and like she didn't have no money, but she hadn't proved that she didn't have any money yet, and everyone's watching her walk over here. He's like, are you lost? She grabs the Eggos. And she's still walking towards the cash register, and he's already screaming, you have to pay for those. I was like, dude, like, you don't know that she's not going to stop yet.
And if it was an adult and she came in like that, I would agree. Because yeah. then you don't know and you can't just shout things.
She could have money somewhere.
This is a child and he was trying to make sure she was okay first and she was not paying attention. And then but I was mad that he was shouting, you have to pay for those, as opposed to, come back here, we want to help you.
Yeah.
But and how hilarious cute. As she walks out, it was almost like throwing the match back.
Just like, oh, yeah.
Shatter.
Well, we meet Carol again from the Indiana AV Club. This was an interesting, smart way of them to get these kids' names.
Yeah, very, very smart. First, I'm thinking, oh, no, Clark, you're a goner. You're a goner. Dead. But then I realized that they were being smarter, like what they did with Hopper, by bugging his place instead of just killing him.
But totally illegal to give out children's names when you're not in school.
It's the 80s.
Yeah, I don't actually. Oh, I can't say one way or the other, but the laws may have been different back then.
Yeah, I mean, I'm sure they were.
And he thinks he's doing a great thing, giving these kids an opportunity that they wouldn't have normally. So of course he's just thinking, oh yes, these students would be great for this because this is totally up their alley. Which, I mean, it's a little too perfect, you know?
Well, and another one, just a funny comparison of just like, yeah, that is how the 80s was. The fact that Nancy and Jonathan could just walk on up into that store.
Lighter fluid.
We're gonna get chase monsters.
What are you guys doing with that? Yeah.
A bear trap.
Monsters. I'm 16. Right. I'll take these bear traps, four boxes of bullets, these large 10-inch nails.
Okay. Sure thing.
Okay.
Well, I'm very happy Mike realized that 11 was trying to protect her. At that
protect
young
him,
age.
Yeah.
Well, them, yeah. And at that age, you know what I mean? To be able to think like that and be like, oh, you know what? Maybe she wasn't doing something for this purpose.
Because
it was for the better good.
He's in love, Jesse.
You know who I love is Dustin because he put Mike in check.
Oh, yeah. Dustin is reading Mike for filth right now. He's just like, you're doing this. Lucas is mad at you because this girl came along. Y'all was best friends, did everything together. Now all of a sudden, she moved into your basement and now you can't talk about anything except for this little girl. When you gonna open up your eyes and realize?
And how grown of Dustin to be like, Lucas is your best friend, right? And he's like, yeah. Okay, fine. You met him first, so like
Dustin
really from first grade.
He wasn't even like, okay, fine. He's just like, look, I get it. Like, you've known him longer. Like, it doesn't bother me. Like,
but I loved how Mike was like, I can have many best friends, and you're my best friend too, Dustin. That melted my little heart.
Yeah, that was everything.
I love Dustin. I love Dustin. And I love Mike. I know. Okay. My friends are crazy. I love them.
But Lucas melted. Wasn't having it. He was like, look, we can do the spit swatch thing, but if you rolling with her, I ain't about it. So Lucas goes.
I'm pissed at Lucas.
You're always pissed at Lucas, though.
Lucas is not a ride
Roxy
or die.
And Lucas would never
they
get
were
along.
Not. They are clashing right now.
I need Lucas to be all in. I mean, I'm happy with Lucas because he seems to be the only one who's really focusing on Will, and that's good. So, but I wish he could say, listen, I'll help you guys get your little girlfriend back. That is what it is. But then Will, we got to go to Will. I'm all about that.
I do love that he initially saw the electric guy and that, like, flagged something for him. When Lucas left out, he took
well,
a
Lucas
look
is
over.
Really smart. We've seen that. I mean, he's very, very smart. And especially, and he's also fearless, doing this by himself, the compass and all of that
That's
stuff. But I love to see that click, too. It was a good
That's
moment.
That's crazy.
He follows, I mean, now that Eleven's not bending it, he follows the compass and it immediately leads him right to the lab.
Yep. That was really interesting when he was like going, how he like thought to go back around the gate.
Yeah.
Just
to
like double check it. Mm-hmm. And then he came across that lab.
And then he saw all those vans leaving. To go get his friends.
Two and two. This is where cell phones would have been amazing in the 80s.
I mean that. Or where are your walkie-talkies, man?
All right, so after Dustin tells Mike that Lucas is jealous, they go out and scream for 11. And this is where Piss Pants and the other bully show up.
Piss Pants.
I hate them so much. There can't be people like this in the world.
First of all, why are you hunting in the woods? Like, and you randomly think like, oh, we're going to come across Mike in these woods right here.
I think
he's going to
follow
pay.
Them
yeah,
there
I know,
or something.
That's crazy.
He's going to pay for making me piss my pants.
I know he did something.
Something scientific-y.
When we see them come over the hill, like, we're thinking like, oh my God, it's the monster.
Yeah, I got nervous.
Like, who knows what's coming? It's the Hawkins lab people. But somehow the bullies coming up over it, made me even more worried than anything
me too.
Else.
These guys are mean bullies. This is worse than writing that somebody's a slut. He tried to make this kid commit suicide.
Yeah, yes. That was intense.
Which, Roxy, you asked if there's people like this in the world, and yes, there are, because online bullies do this to kids all the time.
Yeah.
It's just a different, and just, it's a different it's a decade, different, different form.
Yeah, different decade. This is like, I'm going to hold a knife to your best friend's mouth.
But there's a difference. Like, I mean, both are terrible, but like, the reason that it's so prevalent online is because there's a detachment. It's a lot easier to say some mean stuff than just hold a knife to somebody's throat and say, walk the plank.
It's scary when you have a bully who has a bully friend, because at least bullies that are acting by themselves don't have anybody else being like, yeah, do that, you're right. There's two of them, and it's really, really scary. One of them seems like a little bit less of a bully, but Piss Pants, really bad dude. Where are his parents? He needs better parenting.
Maybe that's the problem. Maybe his parents aren't around and he just is looking for attention. Mm. And this is the only
Which
way he knows
most bullies
how to do.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Scared.
But you know, murder is not the way to do it. Just saying. And Roxy, you pointed out that the foreshadowing of this scene with Hops the other day when he was standing there during the search party, and they were talking about if you were to jump from this ledge, you would definitely die because of the impact of the body in the water.
Right.
So my question to you at home, what went through your mind when Mike stepped to the clip? Did you think he was going to jump in? Did you think he was going to go into a portal? Part of me thought it was jumping into the water and obviously dying was going to somehow open up something.
No, I knew Elle was there, and I was shouting Wingardium Leviosa all day. And that's what Elle did, because Elle is a good friend, which is why she deserves to be a member of this boys' group. And it sucks to be a girl when the boys won't let you in the club.
But I think she earned her place today, though.
The party.
Yes.
She earned her place, I would say today.
She definitely
for sure.
earned her place.
Like no, but meaning, like, Lucas is going to have to kind of be like, oh,
but God. Lucas didn't see that.
It doesn't matter.
He knows.
Dustin is going to bat for this.
Yeah, Dustin will. Because his friend's crazy and he'll kill you.
I think as soon as they get back together and they're like, as soon as she starts actively helping them, Lucas is going to be like, all right. You're good. You're okay.
Or do you think now that Lucas saw the electric company, it's like, whatever, I need to tell the boys what I just saw.
Well, that's assuming he can get to them in time.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. I wrote this down as my final thought, but what I see happening is if Lucas doesn't make it there in time, the boys get taken along with Elle in these vans and back to the lab, and Lucas then is the one to blow the whistle and tell the police and everyone, and that's how everyone gets on the same page of, okay, something's crazy going on, because Lucas can then be like, I just saw them take our friends. I went over there, saw the vans. This guy's been sitting outside of my house for a day now.
Lucas is going to save the day.
Lucas is going to I wrote that down. Lucas is going to save the day.
He wants off my crap list.
He does.
All right, because bring it.
And because
bring it,
he
baby,
went off
I see
on his
you.
Own and they were having this fight, that's why he has to do something to redeem himself with the whole group, and that's what happens.
Love it. Yeah. What I also loved, and we all loved because we all screamed, is when 11 came up on the bullies and was like, nah, whoosh, and broke his
broke
pants
his arm,
but didn't kill him.
Yep.
So
she knew when to stop.
Because she's in control. Like, she's in control. When she hurt the two guys in the lab, I don't think that was really a matter of control. She was just acting out. But like, now she's got a hold of her powers. Like, and so she's actively like, I'm not a monster, I don't want to be a bad guy.
Yeah. Like, to prove herself, because then afterwards she passes out and she says, I'm the monster. And just the fact that Mike knew to be like, no, you're not.
But she does what she's supposed to do. Like, now that there's no life, life being threatened, she disarms. She doesn't need to kill. She disarms.
Mm-hmm.
Break the arm.
Yeah. Legit. All right, let's get into some final thoughts.
Okay.
What are you thinking?
So I know we talked a little bit about Jonathan, Nancy, Joyce, and Hopper teaming up, but I'm really looking forward to a sibling team up. I want Joyce and Mike to start communicating here, because they're on the same page. They both have people that are missing, and they're both in separate search parties. And if we can get them together, then we can join the whole cruise together.
Mm-hmm.
I'm really excited for when the monster, like, has to, when we have to deal directly with the monster with, I don't know, whatever team,
I was going to say, like, who do you think?
Whatever combination, like, party we get that's going to go up against this monster, I'm so excited to get there. And with two episodes left, I know it's, like, about to happen. I'm so pumped.
Wait, guys. So, at this point, because we have not seen Barb since she got dragged back in that pool, is Barb still alive?
We saw Will, but we have not seen Barb.
In one of these two episodes, I think we are going to see the two of them together, Barb and Will.
Okay. If I had to predict, I'd say that Barb is alive.
Yeah.
I was going to say the opposite because I feel like someone has to die during this whole experience.
I think
Barb is the character that can go.
Like, Will's the one that got away, but Barb was just a little too slow. Yeah, she's Barb a little just, too in her feelings.
Yeah, Barb was like casually, and it's really sad, but I feel that at the end of the day, Will needs to come back.
Okay.
Yeah. Will needs to come
back. I have a question for you guys before we just go back to the beginning. Jonathan and Nancy. Jancy, you shipping it?
I like Jancy. They held hands. When the mom came in the bedroom, I was like, aw.
And the nurse at the police station was like, he's in love, craziness.
Yeah.
Boys don't go crazy over like that unless they're in love.
Which is true. And same Jancy. Thing with girls, too, because 11 and Mike.
Mm-hmm. Don't mess with her, man.
Well, we want to know what you guys think, so leave your comments down below. Whatever your craziest conspiracy theory is, let us know what you think is about to happen in the next two episodes. Subscribe to youtube.com/Netflix. Also, check us out on iTunes, available for download for free. Hit that subscribe on Stranger Things After Show. You guys can also keep in contact with us and let us know what crazy conspiracy theories you think are going to happen. Tweet me at DJ Jesse J.
You guys can find me at Roxy Stryer.
And you can find me at the Tiana Hobson.
I'm THATZACHWILSON. That's Zach Wilson.
Boom. We're about to binge on the last two episodes, so if you want to see the next chapter, click next.